Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, it is my first and present duty to join with the Right Honourable Gentleman, the Leader of the Opposition, in congratulating my honourable friends who've moved and seconded the Loyal Address. My honourable friend, the member for Booth Ferry, speaks from the vantage point of someone who's had 30 years membership of this House. He was, I believe, PPS to Sir Walter Monckton in about 1956. He became Minister of State for Employment, and so we listened to him with particular interest on what he said about the problems of his constituency. I noticed that he said the port of Goole had a very good present and future because it had proven reliability, something which many other companies could well learn. We are very indebted to him for his constructive work as chairman of the House of Commons Parliamentary Group in helping forward the historic agreement on Hong Kong, which is being considered in Hong Kong and which I hope will shortly come before this House. He played a very constructive role, and it was a very, very important agreement. I noted what he said about Wilberforce from a school in his constituency. There is outside my room a sculpture of Wilberforce, but number 10 can also boast another Wilberforce. It's a cat in black and white, which has equal disdain for both. But it is, in fact, very good at the job which is there to do. May I also thank the seconder of the Loyal Address, my honourable friend, the member for Wiltshire North, or Chippenham, who tackled his task in his usual spirited fashion. Indeed, one never quite knew what was going to come out next. I listened very carefully to what he said about the Ark. May I remind him that the Ark was built to keep its inhabitants dry? They went in dry and they came out dry. And I hope, therefore, that Ark has great relevance to those who occupy the front bench. It was those who went on the Titanic that got wet. However, I think the light touch of my honourable friend conceals, as we saw later in his speech, his very serious study and his very deep felt views about unemployment. And I remember being with him in his constituency in one of the companies which he mentioned, and also I join with him in hoping that the patronage secretary, my right honourable friend, and my right honourable friend the member for Chingford will soon be back in this House, and I join with him also in the tribute he paid to my right honourable friend, the member for Waveney, used to be called Lowestoft, in the work he did for Northern Ireland. Yeah. May I thank and congratulate them both on the way in which they moved and seconded the Loyal Address. Now, the right honourable gentleman, the Leader of the Opposition, had some words to say about a number of things. He spoke about my right honourable friend, the Chancellor. May I say to the right honourable gentleman that I have some very good news for him. At any rate, it's good news for this side of the House. But while the right honourable gentleman was speaking, Barclays decided to cut by 0.5% from 10.5% to 10% the bank rate. That I think is a great tribute to my right honourable friend, with the firmness that he's kept on the money supply, because the money supply figures were out at 2:30 this afternoon and the cut in interest rate came very, very shortly after. Right honourable gentleman also had some points to make about personal taxation. May I remind him, had the rates of the last government stayed in force, we should now be paying $3.5 billion more in income tax than we are. May I also remind him that had we chosen to keep the national insurance surcharge where he left it and apply that money to cut in income tax, the personal rates would be even much below where they are now. But of course he left us with this terrible tax on jobs of national insurance surcharge, and it was we who took off that tax. Now, he made some comments about Keynes, and as far as I can make out, what he was saying was, if we all spend more than we've got, we shall get very rich. It always was a very stupid sentiment. And may I remind him that in the famous white paper, thought to be written by Keynes, the paper pointed out the policies proposed in this paper affect the balancing of the budget in a particular year, but they do not contemplate any departure from the principle that the budget must be balanced over a longer period. He made the classic mistake with Keynes. He took the deficit part without the surplus part in any particular year. Now he tackled me also and asked me about Mr. McGregor. May I make it perfectly clear? I have every confidence in Mr. McGregor. And if some of the coal miners in the Northeast had taken up the contracts which Mr. McGregor won, in other words, if they'd chosen to take the jobs, 1,000 Durham miners would have jobs which they would not have had without Mr. McGregor. I wonder if the Right Honourable Gentleman has the same confidence in Mr. Scargill. I can understand why. Now, Mr. Speaker, may I turn to the gracious speech. As the Right Honourable Gentleman pointed out, coal is not referred to especially in the gracious speech, but he will be aware that the gracious speech contains mainly the legislative part of the government's programme, and the policy, of course, is regularly debated in this House, and I will therefore start off my comments with saying one or two things about the coal industry, because we meet today in the shadow of the longest industrial dispute for many years, and I think that the House will expect me to start by saying something about it. Since our last debate at the end of July, there have been over 100 further hours of negotiations between the NUM and the NCB, mostly under the auspices of ACAS. There have also been discussions between the National Coal Board and NACODS, which clarified some important points and ended in an agreement acceptable to both sides. The National Union of Mineworkers leaders have, however, repeatedly made clear that they haven't budged an inch from their original position that no pit should ever close except on grounds of exhaustion or safety. In the debate on the 31st of July, the opposition urged the National Coal Board to return to the colliery review procedure. The very next day, the chairman of the National Coal Board, Mr. McGregor, made it clear in an official statement that the National Coal Board had never departed from it. Had never departed from it. In Corton Wood, proposals were made, and the National Union of Mine Workers asked to convene a meeting, and they did not do so. They did not go to that meeting, although the other two unions of that industry were prepared to do so, and the Honourable Gentleman knows it. But I must remind the House that the colliery review procedure always envisaged the closure of uneconomic pits. Yes. In a circular in 1973, issued by the then General Secretary of the NUM, Mr. Lawrence Daly, endorsing the procedure and explaining it to NUM branches, he stated that, and I quote, "While the purpose of these meetings, colliery review meetings, is to improve results and secure the maximum efficiency and optimum future for the industry and those who work in it, It was recognised that some pits would have to close, either through exhaustion or because of heavy losses or changing markets. That was recognised right from the cholera review procedure, and of course that was pointed out to the Select Committee on Energy in its report in 1982. Now, of course, it is the duty of the National Coal Board, backed by the government, to cushion the effects of such closures and to give hope to the communities in which they occur. And for the first time ever, the National Coal Board, under Mr. McGregor, has said that any miner wishing to remain a miner will be able to do so. That is Mr. McGregor's guarantee. But for those who wish to leave the industry, the government has supported the National Coal Board in providing the most generous early retirement terms ever. And we have backed the Coal Board in setting up an enterprise company charged with encouraging new businesses in areas affected by pit closures, as was also done in the steel industry, where the redundancies were more concentrated. I understand that in the case of steel, British Steel Corporation industry has helped to create 20,000 new jobs, with 16,000 more already in the pipeline. And I hope that the new National Coal Board Company can be just as successful, although in a smaller way, because the redundancies in any area are far fewer. But Mr. Speaker, preserving steelworks with virtually no demand for their products, or pits which are becoming exhausted or running at a very heavy loss, provides neither hope nor prospect to young people. And it is far better that we put the money in the National Coal Board enterprises, which is exactly what we are doing, and far better that we encourage inward investment, as my right honourable friends, the Secretaries of State for Wales and Scotland, are constantly doing, and the amount of inward investment we're getting into this country. Mr. Speaker, the issue at the heart of this dispute is the right and duty of the National Coal Board to manage in a way which secures the efficient development of the coal mining industry. That right and duty was recognised in the original Nationalisation Act of 1946, as well as in Plan for Coal 1974 and the tripartite agreements by which it was accepted, and the Coal Industry Acts of 1965 and 1977, both passed by Labour governments. And a settlement which preserves the National Coal Board's right to manage and which meets the union's reasonable concerns can be reached. The success of the negotiations between the National Coal Board and NACODs proves it. Just let me remind the House that as part of that settlement, the National Coal Board not only resolved a number of matters specific to NACODs, but it addressed issues central to the dispute. Indeed, the National Coal Board undertook first to reconsider their 6th of March proposals in the light of the changed circumstances of both supply and demand in the market for coal. It undertook that the five pits about which the unions were particularly concerned would remain open to be considered in common with all other pits under the colliery review procedure. It undertook to enhance the review procedure to include an independent review body to whose advice full weight would be given by the National Coal Board. I believe that the agreement between the National Coal Board and NACODs is fair and reasonable. I do not believe that the National Coal Board has room for any further movement. Mr. Speaker, even after 35 weeks of this strike, the leadership of the National Union of Mineworkers has a choice. Either it can continue to manipulate the loyalties and exploit the fears of those who are on strike, knowing as it does so the hardship and suffering it is inflicting on their families. It can continue to wreak yet further damage on the coal industry, to add to the £500 million in lost wages, the 20 lost faces, and the thousands of lost customers. And it can continue to refuse to budge an inch from its impossible demands. But if it does those things, it must know the suffering it is inflicting, and it must know that the National Coal Board cannot and will not yield. Yeah. And when the Right Honourable Gentleman talks about human feeling and suffering. May I ask him to think about the suffering which the National Union of Mine Workers is inflicting on many of the striking miners and their families. Or the National Union of Mine Workers, or the National Union of Mine Workers can accept the offer which lies upon the table. The best investment program ever, the best ever guarantee of employment, the best ever early retirement terms, and the best ever pay. Mr. Speaker, I believe that scores of thousands of miners, in addition to the one-third of miners who are now at work, are longing to accept this offer. This week alone, so far, over 1,200 miners have returned to work, despite the violence and intimidation, and despite the efforts to intensify the strike, an extra 1,200 miners this week. If the leadership of the National Union of Mine Workers, without consulting their membership, rejecting their desire for a ballot, persist in refusing this deal, the House is entitled to ask, do they want to end this strike, or do they seek to prolong it for reasons which have little, if anything, to do with jobs and pay, but have everything to do with extra parliamentary challenge to this House and to this government? Why have they chosen to seek assistance from the Libyan government, which used its embassy for murder on the streets of London? The leader of the opposition was right to condemn this sinister alliance, and what he said will be endorsed by all right-minded people. Mr. Speaker, there is no industrial reason why this strike should go on one day longer. And for the sake of the mining industry, for the sake of the mining communities, and for the sake of every miner and his family, I say end it now. For this strike, pursued by the National Union of Mine Workers in the name of jobs, is in fact destroying jobs. If customers can't rely on a secure supply of coal, they won't burn it, they will turn to other fuel. But the Labour Party has supported this strike no matter what the cost, no matter what the damage, no matter how many jobs are lost. By their words, they denounce unemployment. So do we. By their deeds, they help to create it. Indeed, by their deeds over this, they forfeit any right to lecture us on this side of the House on the creation of jobs. Mr. Speaker, the gracious speech reaffirms that the government remains deeply concerned about unemployment and will continue policies designed to achieve better opportunities for employment. We would all like to return to...
quoted in her speech from the 1944 Coalition White Paper on Unemployment, she has a responsibility to say to the House whether she accepts, as that government did, the primary aim and responsibility of maintaining a high and stable level of employment. Is that the policy of this government? If it were, she would carry a great deal more support in some of the other areas in which she is trying to change this government's economic policy.
We would all like to return, as I was just about to say, to a low level of unemployment. That's the first paragraph of that paper says that we should accept as one of our primary aims the maintenance of a high and stable level of employment after the war. It goes on to say, for government cannot be created by act of parliament or by government action alone. The success of the policy outlined in this paper will ultimately depend on the understanding and support of the community as a whole, and especially on the efforts of employers and workers in industry. For without a rising standard of industrial efficiency, we cannot achieve a high level of employment combined with a rising standard of living. What that paper accepted was that it is a partnership if one is to tackle the problem of defeating unemployment. And it set out many, many things which have been totally ignored, and had they been accepted, would have made it easier to keep jobs easier to be competitive and easier to create jobs in the future. And I, as I indicated at my own party conference, accept most parts of this paper. Indeed, pretty nearly all, except those which over time have changed. Now, we'd all like to return to a low level of unemployment. And in the debate last week, the Leader of the Opposition gave us his miracle cure. May I carry on, because I have quite a long way to go, but I will give way later to the Right Honourable Gentleman. In the debate last week, the Leader of the Opposition gave us his miracle cure. It was increased public spending, he said, not by taxation, but by increased borrowing. That will have the effect, he argues, of increasing demand and public investment, and so produce more jobs. Now, let us examine these points one by one. In the mid-1950s and the mid-1960s, unemployment was only 1.5%. That was a time when public expenditure as a share of national income was only about a third. Between the mid-1960s and the early 1980s, unemployment rose to 12.5%, and the share of public expenditure climbed to between 40 and 45%. Mr. Speaker, if higher public spending could solve unemployment, there would have been no problem for many years now. But it can't, and it hasn't in any country. The truth is that those countries which have been most successful in maintaining employment, the United States and Japan, have taken a far lower proportion of national income in public expenditure than we do. If we were to increase borrowing, not only would we tend to increase interest rates, whereas they've gone down today, to increase them would be damaging in itself, especially to small business and construction, but we should be diverting into the public sector resources which are now going into private sector investment. And private sector investment has gone up in real terms by some 15% over the past year in manufacturing industries and by nearly 13% in service industries. Do we really want... Oh, really? The Right Honourable Gentleman doesn't believe the official statistics of staff of the civil service. 15% up...
Order.
Industries, he wanted a...
Order, say to the Honourable Gentleman, Right Honourable Gentleman, the Prime Minister's not giving way, and unless she does so, he can't intervene.
I will to a moment. I will give away to the Right Honourable Gentleman in a moment. May I come to the end of this particular section? The Right Honourable Gentleman indicated he wanted a strong manufacturing base. So do I. I want a strong service industry base as well. But in fact, what I was saying to him was that private sector investment has gone up in real terms by 15% over the past year in manufacturing industries and by nearly 13% in service industries. And do we really want to take away that investment from the private sector to put it in the public sector? And do we really want to lose the jobs that investment provides? Because those who put forward this recipe conveniently forget the jobs that would be destroyed. May I give way now to the Right Honourable Gentleman who spoke?
I'm most grateful to the Prime Minister. Does she recognise that these excuses have never convinced members on this side of the House? But the new factor now is that they're not convincing members on the opposite side of the House. And they now are beginning to be vociferous in their complaints about the government's own policies. Now, what action does the Prime Minister intend to take to make the complaints about Conservative members? Because they won't allow their political necks to be wrong in the election on this issue. They will wring her neck first.
Obviously, I disagree with the Right Honourable Gentleman. I must remind the Right Honourable Gentleman that it was my arguments and my policies to which President Mitterrand turned to when his own socialist ones didn't work. And as for the notion that we need... Talk about President Reagan, I remind the Right Honourable Gentleman, the proportion in national income taken in public expenditure in the United States is very much lower than is taken in this country. Now, as for the notion that we need to increase demand, the Right Honourable Gentleman knows there is no shortage of demand in this country. Retail sales are up 8% by value on this time last year, and total spending in the economy is also up by 8% in money terms. No shortage of demand. The trouble is that the supply is being met not from this country, but by more competitive industries overseas in some spheres. So Labour's formula offers no solution. And I suspect that the Right Honourable Gentleman knows this, for he tried to make... So they don't like to listen, Mr Speaker, especially to facts and figures. They regard debate as something which they agree with and not something with which they disagree with, and therefore try to stop it from being heard. I suspect that the Right Honourable Gentleman knows that his formula offers no solution, for he tried to make the formula more acceptable last week by calling for a reflation of $2.3 billion compared with the much more astronomic figures of the general election of something like 10 times that amount, and the British government didn't believe him then, and British people didn't believe him then, and they don't believe him now. But if the medicine is no good in the first place, what is the point of just reducing the dose? There are, however, ways to save jobs, to help to create jobs, and to have a higher level of employment. But they raise issues which the benches opposite would prefer not to face. They represent choices which this government has not shirked and will not shirk. Now I will take up the matter of pay in relation to output. Of course everyone would like more pay. If we are to have German or American standards of pay, we have to have German and American standards of efficiency and output per person first. And that is why I always refer to pay in relation to output. Because after years of prices and incomes policies, people came to think they had an automatic right to an increase in pay, regardless of output, and the increase in pay went straight into inflation and not into extra output. Indeed, unemployment is caused by paying ourselves more than the value of what we produce. Indeed, unemployment is caused by paying ourselves more than the value of what we produce. So said the former leader of the Labour Party, the Right Honourable Member for Cardiff South and Penarth in 1976. He said, I quote, "We must ask ourselves unflinchingly what is the cause of high unemployment. Quite simply and unequivocally, it is caused by paying ourselves more than the value of what we produce. There are no scapegoats." This is what the last leader of the Labour Party said. There are no scapegoats. This is as true in a mixed economy under a Labour government as it is under capitalism or communism. It is an absolute fact of life which no government, be it left or right, can alter. The Right Honourable Gentleman knows that that was sound sense which a government in power, be it left or right, had to operate. If wages are too high in relation to what people will pay for goods, they will take their custom elsewhere and jobs will be lost. And time and again, we've seen British firms priced out of the market in cars, in ships, in motorbikes, in washing machines, and in electronic goods. So there is a choice of pay in relation to output. And it's one which employees and management have to make. And there are signs that in some industry, in spite of the yelping of the opposition, the message is getting home. Yesterday, there was some news that workers earning £170 a week at a furniture factory have voted for a 5% pay cut in an effort to create more jobs and save some jobs of their fellow workers. Sense is coming on the shop floor, if not in the opposition. And in a moment, may I get... And for young people, and the Right Honourable Gentleman like me would like more jobs for young people, lower pay also helps to win more jobs. For example, employers find that the Young Workers Scheme has enabled them to take on more young people. Is it not better to take on 3 17-year-olds, paying them £50 a week each, rather than 2 paid £75 a week, with the other one still out of work? And is it not better to train people for a year under the youth training scheme at £26.50 a week rather than leave them unskilled and unqualified with less chance of a job? And, Mr. Speaker, the results are encouraging. Unemployment among school leavers has fallen over the past year, and a far larger proportion of those leaving youth training service schemes are finding jobs than under earlier schemes. But the sad truth is that some unions have blocked opportunities for training and employment for unemployed youngsters by demanding higher pay and more allowances. Faced with a choice, those unions chose higher unemployment rather than lower pay. I give way to the Honourable Gentleman.
I'm grateful to the Prime Minister. Is she now telling the House, confirming to the House and endorsing the statements of the Chancellor of the Exchequer that she believes in a cut in wages?
The Right Honourable Gentleman cannot have been listening. It is pay in relation to output which is the critical factor. It is unit labour costs, unit costs, which matter. Unit costs in this country are still going up at a higher rate than in the United States and Japan. And that, I'm afraid, therefore, does not augur well for our industry unless we get those unit labour costs down. It is pay in relation to output, and that is the critical factor. But the pay factor, of course, is not enough, because the Honourable General recalled that from that white paper I read out, without a rising standard of industrial efficiency, we cannot achieve a high level of employment. And I use the term greater efficiency in all its many aspects. That means doing away with old labour practices, as they have done, for example, in the Tyne ship repair yards, which have been privatised. Working inconvenient hours if necessary. Being the first to accept new technology and to exploit it to the full, not fighting its introduction and use every inch of the way. And it means constantly developing the products and services for the markets of tomorrow. Of course, the major innovations of the past displaced existing products and the jobs of the workers who made them. But each in its own way opened up vast new opportunities and created many new jobs. And the same will be true of the inventions and ideas of today, whether in manufacturing or service industries. Now, Mr. Speaker, these particular things, by their very nature, can't be done by government, but the actions of government could hinder the necessary development in the public sector by subsidising yesterday's industries at the expense of tomorrow's. The goods we are interested in are those which have a relevance to tomorrow's world. But government, if it can't do all of those things, can cut regulations, can reduce controls, can increase competition, and diminish the financial overheads arising from rates and taxation. And this year, the increase in local authority rates has been the lowest for a decade, thanks to our legislation. The National Insurance Surcharge, labour's tax on jobs, was finally abolished last month. So, yes, the route to more jobs does present unpalatable choices for the opposition. Because the Right Honourable Gentleman's party backs every pay demand and every strike, no matter how unreasonable or how damaging. It now resists change, whether the transition from high to low-cost pits or the efficient use of new technology, and it belittles the opportunities presented by the service industries. And his is the party which, to cap it all, would put up personal taxes on wealth creators, and raise inflation, and so nullify the advantage which our industries have so painfully won in the last 5 years. Mr. Speaker, I believe we can only return to a high level of employment if we face up to the difficult choices that I have outlined. And it also requires the unceasing pursuit of sound financial policies by government to bring inflation down and to limit public spending. It requires, too, a commitment to free enterprise, which is wealth-creating, rather than a commitment to the expansion of the public sector, which is wealth-consuming. As the gracious speech showed, we have therefore pursued a programme of returning state industry to the private sector with vigour and determination. 11 major companies and a number of other enterprises have so far been restored to private ownership. Shortly, the public will receive a prospectus for British Telecom setting out the terms on which the largest ever transfer of a company from state control is being offered. And this session will carry forward the process of opening up the coach and bus industry to competition. And we hope to see the return to the private sector of British Airways, a company which has responded magnificently to the spur of competition and to the prospects ahead. Mr. Speaker, oh, very far from it. Please don't let the honourable member cherish any such hopes. I come now to local government. The gracious speech refers to the major bill we shall be bringing forward very soon to abolish the 6 metropolitan councils and the Greater London Council. We want local government to be closer to the people. For the metropolitan councils, this means that the metropolitan districts will be the local authorities. For London, it means the boroughs. I believe that even the opposition are not seriously in favour of retaining the metropolitan councils. But to them, the GLC is different, even though it accounts for only 11% of local government spending in London. Nevertheless, the GLC is spending £10 million of ratepayers' money, £7 million this year alone, trying to persuade us of the value of its services. Not, of course, housing, because most of that was transferred to the boroughs some years ago. Not, of course, education, because a directly elected Ilya and the outer boroughs will do that. Not law and order, the Metropolitan Police do that. Not the tubes and buses, London Regional Transport does that. Not ambulances, the local health authorities do that. Not rubbish collection or libraries, the boroughs do that. But they are spending £7 million this year on propaganda, more than the total local government budget of the City of Oxford, which is £6.5 million, or £6 million on the City of Durham. The GLC has become an intolerable burden for London's ratepayers. Its rate has risen by over 100% in the last 3 years, but its spending days are nearly over. And with Parliament's approval, it will come to an end on the 31st of March 1986. Mr. Speaker, the gracious speech sets out our approach to foreign affairs and defence. I begin by reporting to the House that, together with the Leader of the Opposition and the leaders of other parties, I've just returned from Delhi, where we mourned with the people of India at Mrs. Gandhi's funeral. History and friendship gave us a special close feeling for India. We all wish the new Prime Minister well in the great task of reconciliation, which will surely be needed in the days and months ahead. Mr. Speaker, as the Right Honourable Gentleman, one of the movers and seconders, said, we're very much aware that we opened this session of Parliament on the day of perhaps the most important election in the Western world. But once that election is over, many tasks which have inevitably been held up will be resumed, in particular, the lessening of tensions between East and West. The gracious speech speaks of our working continually for a greater atmosphere of trust between the two sides. That will be our aim. It is the reason why we shall in the coming months be welcoming 2 senior representatives of the Soviet Union to Britain. Mr. Gorbachev has accepted the invitation of the Chairman of the Select Committee on Foreign Affairs and of the British Group of the IPU to visit Britain in December. He'll also be calling on members of the government, opposition and other party leaders. Mr. Gromyko has also indicated that he hopes to visit London next year. My Right Honourable friend, the Foreign Secretary, and I look forward to seeing them both. And we shall hope during their visits to take forward the search for ways to reduce the burden of armaments. And with our Western partners, we have made far-reaching but practical proposals in every arms control negotiation. At Stockholm, Vienna and Geneva, it is the West which has made the running. So far, the response from the Soviet Union, there and elsewhere, has been unforthcoming. But the Soviet Union did propose talks on limiting weapons in space, but they then refused to take yes for an answer. But when the Soviet government find the political will to respond positively, to resume their empty chairs at the nuclear negotiating table, they will meet a ready response. We want security at a lower level of weapons and at a lower cost, provided always that reductions are balanced and verifiable. But this government will not put at risk our national security or peace by giving up our nuclear defences while our greatest potential enemy keeps theirs. And we should remember that the possession of the nuclear deterrent has prevented not only nuclear war, but also conventional war. At one time, this used to be common ground between the parties. Indeed, after the last war in the 1940s, it was the Labour government of Mr. Attlee which first provided Britain with nuclear weapons. In the 60s and 70s, the Labour government, under the noble Lord Wilson and under the Right Honourable Member for Cardiff South, maintained Polaris and later confirmed the decision to modernise it with Chevalier. In 1976, it was the Right Honourable Member for Sparkbrook who said, "It is not and never has been my view that unilateral renunciation would promote peace in the world." And in 1981, the Right Honourable Member for Leeds East said, "The only real answer to the nuclear threat is multilateral disarmament and not unilateral gestures." Over the last three or four decades, Labour, both in government and opposition, affirmed again and again that nuclear weapons were crucial to the defence of the West and to the preservation of peace. Well, what's changed? Not the defence needs of the West, but the Labour Party itself. And now, not content with getting rid of Britain's own nuclear deterrent, the Labour Party is committed to the unconditional removal of all United States nuclear weapons and nuclear bases from British soil and British waters. So to our American allies, Labour would be saying, "We don't want your nuclear weapons on our soil, but we still expect you to help to defend our freedom." The opposition's policies would, I believe, hand the Soviet Union a major military, political and propaganda advantage in return for nothing. Would greatly diminish the value and credibility of Britain's contribution to the NATO alliance. Would sabotage the close relationship between Britain and the United States, and would strike at the whole basis of the peace and security which NATO has brought to Europe for the past 35 years.
Relationship with the American allies is quite so close. Why is it that the Americans use their vote to vote against us in the United Nations on the Falklands?
Yeah. Speaker, I am talking about NATO. And may I make it clear, we believe in the NATO alliance, we believe in honouring its policies, and we believe in staying loyal to our American allies, and we are very grateful for the tremendous effort which they put in to the defence of Europe. As the gracious speech says, this government considers its highest priority the maintenance of national security and will uphold the strategy of NATO and honour our obligations to our principal ally. Not so, honourable and right honourable gentlemen opposite. Mr. Speaker, in the coming session, I believe we shall have to face a matter which lies at the heart of parliamentary government. Many of the measures in the gracious speech will be keenly contested. Nobody can complain about that. The opposition can and will criticise, oppose, amend or delay any bill before this House. But once that bill has been passed through Parliament to become law, that law must be obeyed equally and by all. Yeah. disagree as governments and oppositions will on policy, on that constitutional convention we were united. In recent months, Mr. Speaker, I fear that convention has been under threat. As we saw only last month in Blackpool, there are some in the Labour Party today who hold the law and the courts to be nothing more than obstacles in the way of their political objectives. On Wednesday, the 3rd of October, the Labour Conference passed a motion giving its official backing to lawbreakers. The motion promised to support local councils, and I quote, forced to break the law as a result of the Tory government's policies. Forced to break the law, Mr. Speaker. In a democracy where you can vote at least once every 5 years to change the law through the ballot box, no one is forced to break the law. And that is not the language of those who believe in democracy, nor of those who believe in law. The gracious speech, like its predecessors, depends upon that fundamental constitutional convention, which, because of the attitude of some in the Labour Party, is in danger of breaking down. This year, let it be seen that those who deny the duty to uphold the rule of law, those who use violence for political ends, those who deny the ascendancy of the ballot box and the supremacy of Parliament, find no support in any part of this Honourable House. Yeah.